It was really hard when researching and planning this episode not to make this section just another of the many making of hysteria stories that are out there. I've tried really hard to make this just about Mutt Lange and his part in the album, but the two are so inextricably linked that there's inevitably some crossover. And I am a huge fan of this album, so please allow me some leeway as I present my research to you. I figure you're here, you're probably interested anyway. The truth of these things gets lost in Chinese whispers down through the years. One journalist writes a quote and changes a few words here and there. Another reprints it later but attributes it to the wrong person 3 decades later, and stories have become legends, and the truth is kind of hard to get to. The closest you're ever going to get to a version of the truth is by listening to, not reading, because that can be easily distorted, but listening to the people who were there tell their version of what happened. So with that in mind, I've put together a package of clips from a variety of sources that I hope tells a pretty definitive version of the story of Mutt Lange's involvement with and influence on hysteria. We're going to be hearing from the band members, their managers, Peter Mensch and Cliff Bernstein, and Mutt himself. A lot of this audio is taken from the extremely good Classic Albums Hysteria episode that is just a must-see if you haven't seen it. Other clips are from In the Studio, the Rock of Ages documentary, the Virgin Radio YouTube channel, and the Def Leppard YouTube channel. If you want to make a cup of tea, now's the time to pause the show and go and put the kettle on, because this next segment runs about 25 minutes. You ready, Tom?
I got my coffee in my hand. I'm reclining. I'm listening. Let's do it. When we got together with Mutt to start seriously writing Hysteria, he throws you the, why can't a rock band have 7 hit singles off one album? Almost write a greatest hits album before they're released. And that's exactly what we set out to do.
If Michael Jackson can sell 40 million or whatever, I honestly don't believe that it's not a fluke. There are billions of people in this world. And if you make, the way we've always looked at the Leps music is if we can actually learn the craft of writing songs and improve that craft, which is what all of us are trying to do, I mean, every member of that band is actually coming in with good songs now. If not good songs, at least a quarter of a good song. So that's something they never had before. So I can actually see their graph. If the same kind of concentration and intent is put into the thing, I can see the graph going up still further, really.
The idea was that this record was not going to come out until it was an absolute bona fide classic record.
It was a philosophy that the management company held, the producer held, and the band were taught, which was, it was all killer, no filler.
When we finished the Pyromania tour, we were still very young. We'd gone from just being a bunch of kids that, you know, lived at home to just going out on the road and becoming, you know, a 6 million selling act. We came to Dublin in February 84. Literally straight from Bangkok. We flew in having done the last show. All 5 of us lived in this house. And I mean, it was like the comic show, The Young Ones. It was just crazy. The amount of alcohol consumed was just beyond belief. But the job on hand was to write the follow-up album to Pyromania. And I think reality would be that we were a little scared, you know, and we didn't know what to do. And so we just kept kind of putting it off. And like, we'd just do little bits and bobs and then get drunk and then pretend it was great and then listen to it the next day and it was awful, you know. And we got a few things done.
We got a call in from Dublin saying, you know, we just wrote this great song, we just demoed it. And we said, will you send it over to us? And we heard Animal. And we went, oh, that's it, we got it. We don't have to worry about the next album. And other songs followed that we just knew, hey, all they got to do is record these songs. We thought this is going to be easy. All they have to do is record these great songs, and we will have a fantastic follow-up to Pyromania. It was a little harder than that, actually.
It was 6 months just writing with Mutt, and that's when he, you know, just as we were coming to the end of that session, is when he said, I can't do the album. And we're like, you're kidding me, right? You know, he'd been at it without a break. This we're talking middle of 84. He'd been at it nonstop since he arrived in the UK about 1975.
He actually bailed on Heartbreak City by the car. Is it Heartbeat City? By the Cars, and let Mike Shipley mix it because he was just exhausted. And he said, I'll sit in for the pre-production, but I can't produce the record. So we had to go through this whole process of trying to find somebody to replicate what Mutt did, which is impossible because he's the number one.
He was apologetic. He talked to the band about it, and he suggested that we find another producer, which we then set about trying to do. It's tough to replace a genius, though, I'll tell you that much.
Well, there was a lot of different episodes in the making of the record. I mean, it went over a four-year period. You know, we had a little episode with Jim Steinman being a producer.
It was clear early on that Def Leppard had become Langerized, for better, you know, because everything, whatever Steinman wanted to do, it wasn't going to be the same way Mutt did it.
The thing that was, I think, the icing on the cake, or the last nail in the coffin lid, as far as Phil and Steve were concerned, was one day we were running through a song called Don't Shoot Shotgun, and Jim came on the talkback and went, I think we got it there, guys. And they just looked at each other and said, we haven't even chunged up yet. You know, he says, yeah, but it sounds honest. He says, yeah, but to a kid in Boise, Idaho, it sounds out of tune, Jim.
Paid Steinman a ton of money to buy him out of his deal, which meant essentially that we had to sell a couple of million records to make up the money that we paid for Steinman.
We were really floundering. You know, we had these songs and we'd started them off with Mutt, and we were doing a lot of things very wrong.
Then we worked with Nigel Green, who was Mutt's engineer.
Nigel was great. Nigel worked with us all the way through the album. He came in, he still engineered it when Mutt came back. But we were all second-guessing what would Mutt do, you know, which is, like, really difficult because Mutt never has a plan. It's all, like, in here, and he never lets it out. He goes, no, 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 yes. Why is that a yes and those three a no? I don't know. Just is, you know. Okay. The learning curve was pretty hard. And when we were working with Nigel, we were busting our nuts trying to... And we were making Pyromania 2. We absolutely were. It was a good record, but it wasn't what... say, Night at the Opera was from the leap it was from Sheer Heart Attack, and that's what we wanted to do.
But it actually wasn't until after I had my accident that Mutt got involved proper, as it were, and actually embraced the record and decided that it was probably a good idea if he helped us finish it.
When I arrived at the hospital, he was actually, I could see that he was really down. I mean, he was trying to keep a pretty brave face, but he was prostrate. I mean, really prostrate at that point, not knowing which limbs were going to work at all. And then I just mentioned to him that he could, conceivably, if he could get his right hand to work again, he could actually play the drums by repeating the sounds on the top and the bottom. And he then, as he lay there, he started just doing that thing with his limbs. And I could actually see almost a light shine, you know, in his eyes, in terms of that. He thought, yeah, that's actually the one way out of it, you know. And literally from that day on, in my perception, the few times I saw him, he had a cause. And then I actually mentioned it to the band. And I said to Peter Manchin, I said, Rick really could play. If it's just going to take time. We were going to record the album, so he had a lot of recuperative time. So all the time, he was just playing in his bed, in his mind. He was trying to coordinate his limbs. Then he got onto some local Sheffield guy who got the process going, who got him some makeshift pedals together and everything, and he started getting it right. And he would just come into all of us every now and again and say, what do you think of this? And you'd go, or something. You'd go, great, Rick, you know. But apart from just getting that together, he actually had to create rhythm, you know, and be as powerful as he was. And he did it. I mean, he did it on his own, completely.
We needed a visionary we needed a sounding board. And we had all these ideas, but we had no idea how to get them down. Mutt Lange knew, he'd been working, look at the records he'd made before Hysteria. You know, you can start from, for those about to rock, and work backwards, and then you go, wow, you know. So he knew what he was doing, and we needed his expertise. And when he came back in, we had his vision and his confidence to do that. He really believed in what we were doing, but we needed a director.
When Mutt came back in, it was a different era. You know, we started on a Fairlight machine, which is what used to be used as a sampler. Fairlight 1 and a 2, and then we went to Synclavier. So all these technology was going crazy.
And we were hearing these new bands making totally different kind of music to us, bands like Frankie Goes to Hollywood or The Human League, using all this electronic stuff and thinking, wouldn't it be great to be able to incorporate that into rock, you know? And Mutt was very open to that, and he knew that we were, so there was never a kind of a juxtaposition of like butting heads, like, no, can't go there, we've got to be this traditional rock band. It's like, no, we need to be standalone. We wanted to be as out there as Queen were, you know, we wanted to be as out there as Kate Bush was.
There you go. Gee, I don't know whether he's... That sounds like Mutt again, actually. Oh, here we go. That sounds like Mutt as well. Really took 3 years to get that song to the stage it ended up on the album. We actually done the guitars first and then done the vocal, threw everything away and started again from scratch.
It was unfocused until Mutt came on board, and then when he came on board and sorted it all out, and without wanting to break anybody's hearts, we basically redid the album.
Phil and Mutt might be locked away in a room for 2 or 3 hours and come out with something. Sometimes the lot of us would sit together, or me and Mutt would sit together, or Sav. You know, it was just whatever worked on that particular day.
Yeah.
But he was a big part of it. When you've got a talent like him wanting to work with you, you don't handcuff them. It's like, let them breathe, you know? I mean, George Martin with the Beatles, or Phil Spector with every artist he ever worked with, you know, I mean, that's what you've got to do, really, and that's what we wanted. The reason we wanted to work with Mutt, because his embodied work that he'd done interested us in working with someone like him. We thought, imagine the sounds that he could get on an album like Back in Black if we could apply that to what we wanted to do, which was be a mixture of Queen and AC/DC.
And with a song like Hysteria, you'd break that up into totally different parts. You know, you'd have one guitar going. Instead of doubling that up with that again, the other guy would be playing. And you'd also have another guitar over the top going.
Mutt dragged a lot out of us that we wouldn't have necessarily put on the table ourselves. He knew it was there, it needed mining. You know, he's a great leader in that respect. He would cajole and pull. He had willing participants. We were never like, some of the people that he's worked with in the past said, I'm not doing that. We were like, no, let's give it a go. And we would spend a week doing something and then abandon it.
I think there are times during the making process where you're just not enjoying it. You're tired. You're fed up of playing this bass line for the 20th time. And to my ears, it's exactly the same as the first take that I did, but not to Mutt.
And it's not like you're doing that wrong. It's like, no, it hasn't got the right feel. It should be like this, and it'll go somewhere else with it. It's just like a constant flow of inspiration. So I love working with him personally, and he really taught me how to play guitar and sing.
Mutt wanted you to do things a certain way, and he would present it to you in such a way that you would challenge yourself, as opposed to trying to make you do it. You know what I mean? You'd wanna get it right. You'd wanna do it.
Like a stereo amalgamation of everybody's voices, very chopped, so you get this, it's just like a chorus type effect, and then we add the BVs.
They were long hours, but you'd think nothing of spending 2 weeks on one verse of a song. I mean, you know, it sounds ridiculous now, but there are elements within the songs that required that sort of detail. And that's what Mutt was known for, and it's what we wanted as well. So in a sense, back then, it was a perfect marriage because Mutt understood what we wanted, but he was probably one of the few people in the world that kind of had the perseverance and the knowledge and just the feel to actually get it.
One day I remember coming back into the studio, I turned at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and they said, come and check this out. And they'd put this whole middle bit in with all this backward stuff and this, like, almost chanting, not like Burundi Black chanting, it was all very sequenced. And at the time, sequencing stuff like that was completely new.
It's all done on this IMS with Nigel Green going, literally triggering it by manually, which is kind of unheard of. And when you hear the whole thing, you'd think, well, that's incredible, because actually still to this day sounds very cool, and all the effective stuff in the middle is all this stuff.
That's We're Fighting for the Gods of War backwards.
Devil's music.
That's the B off Love Bites.
Underneath the guitar solo, we had this kind of monk kind of chanty thing, which was Matt said, that'd be great, just emphasise the melody of the guitar, of the solo and everything, and it'll just enhance it. I mean, it kind of did, but it was a bit embarrassing to do at the time. It was like just standing around a mic going, oh, like a monk or something. But when you hear it, this is them on their own.
There's so many dynamics on this song. I mean, we really went to town. It's got everything in it.
Let's play that again. This is them silly vocals with the guitar. Mutt was going, you know, it's got to be melodic, it's got to be memorable, right down to the guitar solos. It wasn't just like a get to the solo and wank off and have nothing to do with the rest of the song. So, you know, otherwise you wouldn't be able to do stuff like that. Love Bites was kind of, it was a Mutt song, Mutt Lange song. When he brought it in, it was just, it was pure country. He sung it and it was, when you make love, do you look in the mirror? It definitely had a twang to it and stuff. It actually sounded more like Don Henley or something. And, you know, we worked on it, obviously, and it just ended up being very guitar-y.
Mutt Lange is so far and away the most talented producer on the planet. Only he knew where the songs were going. I'm not sure the band didn't even know.
You know, Mutt has an immaculate pop ear, and I think in Mutt's mind, he could never be happy until a song sounded like it was a hit.
This was our first American number one, actually our only American number one single. And it, for good reason, I think. It was.
Well, that's it. I mean, it covered all bases. It's my mom and dad's favorite ever song. And these guys grew up on Sinatra and Nat King Cole. But it's also, you know, my goddaughter's favorite song, and she's 11.
Did start the ball rolling as far as that stuff, the big multi-tracked, I don't want to say glossy, but very well-sung, emotive backing vocals, which did become very popular, especially in R&B and pop.
Am I getting through? Or do you please yourself? When you wake up, will you walk out? It can't be love if you throw it about.
You see, there you go, with the little squeals and stuff that it made me put on the end of all the stuff, which we always used to jokingly call the Simon Le Bon bits, because he used to squeal every line he sang. But what it is, really, it's a common way to get emotion across. If you put a little on the end of something, it kind of, everybody thinks it's sexy and all that kind of stuff. And Mutt's always pushing the sex angle, man. Yeah, you got to appeal to the chicks, man.
I came in late on the album because I wasn't going to do it initially. And when I came in, it was obvious to me that the songs we'd written in the very beginning were like slightly dinosaurish. They were 2 years old, basically. So I kept saying, we need another one. And as we needed another one, there was more and more resistance, to the point where right at the end, the band actually had a meeting with the management to say that whatever Mutt says, they're definitely not going to get another song on the record.
Me and Mutt were working on the vocals for Armageddon It, which was the 11th track on the album, and as far as we were concerned, final track. 5 minute coffee break, Mutt disappears. I go into the control room, and we always had an acoustic guitar knocking around just for ideas. And I started playing this thing that I'd had for, a couple of weeks, which went. Pour some sugar on me. Something along those lines. Mutt comes in the control room and asks me what it was. And I just said it was just this idea that I'd got and just, you know, no big deal. And he said, no, that's the best hook I've heard in like 5, 10 years or whatever it was. I like to think 10, but it was probably 5. And he said, we should do this. We should absolutely do this song. And of course, I'm, you know, thinking, no way that the guys are going to go for it.
And I just knew that we didn't have the record yet. So what the hell are we going to do it, you know?
We end up recording it quite quickly. I think news that we'd written a new song that was really good wasn't what the record company wanted to hear, because the record had taken so long to record. We were spending huge amounts of money making the thing. They just wanted us to finish the record and get the thing out. You know, obviously in hindsight, it was really good that Mutt stood up and said, no, I really think this is what we're missing.
Myself and Mutt Lange had dictaphones, and we actually just went to opposite ends of the control room while it was playing and just made noises over the backing track, and swapped machines and started translating what we thought the words were.
And the first line on Mutt's tapes, to me, sounded like, "Love is like a bomb."
When we brought that mix to the top 40 stations, it just exploded.
I've never sold more albums behind one single in my career than I did with Pour Some Sugar. It literally connected with everybody, a rock audience, a pop audience, older people, younger people, and it's a phenomenon. It sold probably 4 million records during the run of the single, and we shipped 450,000 records in one day of hysteria because of the impact of Pour Some Sugar on me. That's almost going gold in one day.
It was very gratifying to come back off selling so many with Pyromania. A lot of people said, enjoy it, because you're never going to repeat it. And we went on to almost double it. You know, you've got to have a lot of luck, you've got to have a lot of belief, and a lot of things have got to be in the right place. But we were grateful, we were happy. We were having the time of our lives, basically. I mean, it was fantastic.
People forget they were the biggest band in America. I mean, people really forget. I mean, they could sell out America for a year, multiple nights, everywhere.
Hysteria is the thing they had been working for, you know, since they'd been, you know, 14, 15, and 16. And then they did it. They had to do it through the worst, you know, monsoon of shit ever, but they did it. And man, you just can't take that away from them. It is, it's the perfect Def Leppard record.
Everything we went through with hindsight was justified. It could have fallen flat, it didn't. So it does turn out to be like a happy ever after story, but it became a standing and a running joke for us as well. We had Mick Jagger come in and do two solo albums in the same complex while we were still making the first one. You know, and he'd come in for the second album and he's like, bloody hell, you lot are still here. You're not finished yet.
He thought we were some janitors or something.
And it's like, weren't you here doing that album when I came in and did She's the Boss? It's like, yeah. He says, well, I've done that one and I've toured. And
I've had two kids in the meantime.
Two kids, done a Stones album and a tour, and now I'm back doing my next solo album and you're still here, you know?
Still here?
The term finish an album is kind of doesn't apply to Hysteria, because when we walked away from the recording sessions, only Mutt Lange could have tidied it up. It was just a jigsaw puzzle thrown into a bag. He had to put it all together. So as we left the recording sessions, we weren't really sure. We knew the songs were good, but we didn't know. We knew they'd sound okay because it's Mutt Lange. Christ, you know, he doesn't make mistakes. But we didn't know how good it was going to be until the first few mixes started coming in. And we heard Women and we went, oh, yeah, that's good. And then we heard Gods of War and it was like, Christ, this is Kashmir. This is our Kashmir. It's amazing. It just sounded fantastic. And then Animal. And then they all started coming in every couple of days, another mix. It's like, we made this record. It was a team effort. And then it all came together at the end. And Mutt glued it all together.
Mutt taught us never to be too precious with ideas. And that was really important. Just because you've recorded it doesn't mean to say that you can't erase it, you know, and come up with a better idea. His whole philosophy on life, everything, had a huge, huge impact on all of us.
Mutt was as important as any member of the band, and that's the highest compliment I can pay, because there's nobody should really be any more important than any one member. You know, we are the band, and that's the thing. But a producer brings in a focus, and the reason that you employ a producer is to make you better than you are.
If ever I hear about Def Leppard, I always think of myself as part of it, because that's just the way it became. Some bands, you're always the producer and you put on the side. You know, they allowed me in, really.
From the day we started in 77, we wanted to be the biggest band in the world. And by the time that album came out and the tour kicked in, for a little while, we were.
Wow, that was so interesting, so good to hear. The story of Hysteria told by the people who made it, it's all there. That was well done, man. Bravo. That's fantastic.